Hasta la vista, rodents.
You're gonna get beamed up.
Eight Looney Tune villains of biker mice from Mars. Back in the 90s, Throttle, Vinnie, and Modo rocked and rode into our television screens and hearts. The Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, or TMNT, set the trend for anthropomorphic heroes with catchy names in the 90s. Biker mice from Mars followed in their footsteps and gave us the trio of daring mice humanoids who happened to be from Mars. The friends, who could only rely on their brains, bros, and bikes, had a successful run for three seasons and went on to inspire a line of toys, comics, and a video game. The concept of biker mice from Mars was similar to TMNT, and the parallels were quite obvious. Charley Davidson's name was a play on the Harley Davidson motorcycle, and she was the show's April O'Neil. The cybernetic weapons in their bodies made the biker mice quite powerful, and the show struck a unique balance between kids' action cartoon and heavy metal.
What do you want, you drooling dog face?
It was one of the few cartoons at the time to use climate change as their ongoing plotline. Throttle, Modo, and Vinnie fought against the evil Plutarkians, who ruined Mars. The show was revived with a brand new series in 2006. It was more of a continuation of the original story than a reboot. In today's video, we will talk about eight of the looniest villains who appeared on the show.
Before we go into our explanation, we have a very small request. If you like our content, please support us by subscribing to our channel. This is a small click for you, but for us, it means a lot. Thank you, and let's begin.
Love you to pop in, vermin. As the acting mayor, I've just finished ordering your destruction.
Lawrence Limburger, Rock and Ride. The episode starts with the biker mice traveling through space, while their spaceship is targeted and attacked by a Plutarkian. The mice decide to abort the ship on their bikes, and they crash land into a scoreboard in the middle of a baseball game. Vinnie saves a hot dog vendor from a thug while riding out of the stadium, and the mice land up in the middle of a barren land that looks familiar to them. Meanwhile, a greased-up thug harasses Charlie and threatens her to sign over her garage to Mr. Limburger. The mice arrive at her garage in hopes of getting their rides repaired. They chase out the greased-up thug and rescue Charlie and her garage.
Time to roll, sweetheart!
Mr. Limburger ain't gonna like that!
The mice introduce themselves to Charlie and tell her the story of how the Plutarkians took over Mars and rid the planet of its resources. Charlie notices the similarities between the incidents and tells the mice that the same thing was happening on Earth. The mice smell Plutarkians on the mess left behind. The greased-up thug reports back to Mr. Limburger about how he was interrupted by the biker mice from Mars while he was trying to take over the Last Chance garage. Mr. Limburger recalls how much of a hindrance the mice were while taking over Mars and instructs Carbuncle to come up with a solution to take them down.
Those biker rebels have now come to Earth, and I want to know what you are going to do about it.
Lawrence Limburger was an evil Plutarkian who focused on conquering other planets to strip them of their resources. The mice population had resisted him while he took over Mars. Unfortunately, most of the mice population got wiped out, and the biker mice were one of the few who survived. They had been kidnapped to be experimented on by Carbuncle, but they managed to escape. After ruining Mars, Limburger wanted to steal the resources from Earth for his home planet. He was parading around disguised as a human and industrialist operating from Chicago. The biker mice unmasked his fish face after sniffing the Plutarkian stink around him. He used to deploy his minions to do his dirty deeds. He sent Greasebit to intimidate people into submitting to his demands and relied on Carbuncle's inventions to torment his enemies. Despite his cunning ways and innumerable resources, the biker mice always managed to outwit him and foil his plans. Lawrence Limburger returned when the show was revived. Instead of being the main antagonist, he returned as a lackey for the pit boss, and his appearance had drastically changed since the original series. He teamed up with Napoleon Brie and planned to steal regenerators for his home planet. But his plans were interrupted by Catalina Catacall. The regenerator purge turned him into a regular fish. Instead of being an evil overlord, he ended up as a mere fish in an aquarium.
land is ruined. Then you just volunteer to clean it up, and you can dig up all you want.
Carbuncle, big trouble. The biker mice and Charlie were playing around without realizing that Limburger's minions were hiding in the ground. Their ball hit Grispit in his hiding spot, and he called out to the other goons to chase them out. Charlie decided to help her friends out by shooting down the enemies. She ended up hitting a statue that began leaking grease. Seeing Charlie covered in grease, Grispit developed a crush on her.
You really hate them? Except for their buddy Charlie. Wow, what a pistol.
Meanwhile, Lawrence Limburger was worried about pleasing an important Plutarkian who was arriving to get sulfur for Plutarch. Lawrence had assigned his minions to collect sulfur, but they were failing to do so because of the biker mice. Carbuncle had come up with a new invention that would enlarge the size of any particle.
Always a distinct displeasure.
Cut the cheese, Limburger. I want to see my sulfur.
He used his inflation machine to enlarge the portion of sulfur they had to deceive the Plutarkian VIP. Carbuncle's invention wasn't without flaws. The particles would remain enlarged only for 2 hours and then go back to their regular shape. Limburger and Carbuncle decided to convince the other Plutarkian that he was sick and needed to be quarantined for 2 hours, which would buy them enough time to make up for their sulfur shortage. The biker mice had landed upon the sulfur mine and managed to tie up most of the thugs surrounding the place. Greasepit accidentally enlarged his hand with the inflation machine while trying to enlarge the flowers he wanted to bring Charlie. This gave Lawrence Limburger an idea, and he convinced Greasepit to enlarge him himself and terrorize the biker mice. His plan worked for a while, but no mess was too big for our heroes.
I am pleased to report that my mind bender beam is ready and awaiting some.
Carbuncle is always seen wearing a lab coat and a distinct pair of green goggles. His crazy inventions and actions have been quite the hindrance for the biker mice. He had attempted to experiment on them while they were held captive after their rebellion on Mars. He was the reason why Modo ended up with a bionic arm. Throttle with his bionic eyes, and Stoker's bionic tail. He used to work for Limburger's superior, but he switched sides after he was bribed. Carbuncle's main tasks were to develop robots and machines to help go after the biker mice and collect resources from Earth. He also used his dimensional transporter to look up the villain of the week. He returned in the revived series only to meet a similar fate to that of Lawrence Limburger. He had left Limburger's side to work with the Catatonians to help them with the regenerators. He was turned into a turtle after his rift with Dr. Catorkian. Carbuncle was a sadistic psychopath who enjoyed torturing people. He would constantly use Fred the Mutant as a guinea pig for all of his experiments.
Maybe now you'll see Mr. Limburger's generous offer in a new light.
Greasepit. The Reeking Rain of the Head Cheese, Part 2. The gang stumble upon a giant pit while going on a ride. They suspect the stink of Limburger all over the mess and come across him and Greasepit digging through the ground. Limburger orders Greasepit to crush the biker mice using the excavator. As usual, Greasepit fails to carry out his task and gets his vehicle rendered useless as the biker mice tie it up. Limburger is pressured by the chairman of Plutarch to hand over Earth. Carbuncle invents a deadly robot with magnetic powers to take care of the biker mice.
Office, let's test the construction, biker mice.
The robot puts up a good fight but gets decapitated by the rodents. Next, Greasepit and some other goons dress up as the biker mice and kidnap the mayor. Limburger takes control of the city and makes Greasepit the chief of police.
There's them rodents now. Let's bust their tails. All right, you goons, make like the fuzz and wail.
He is assigned with the task of catching the mice and putting them behind bars. Charlie informs the biker mice about Limburger's shenanigans and they ride to rescue the mayor. Charlie decides to investigate what Limburger was up to and goes undercover posing as his assistant. Greasepit chases after the mice and succeeds at arresting them.
Missed me, Mousy.
Well, some days you catch the mouse, some days the mouse.
However, he doesn't manage to capture them for long as the judge finds them not guilty. Charley discovers that Limburger is planning to demolish a diamond store and other occupied buildings throughout the city. Carbuncle brings him a tunnel rat to dig through the city and go after the biker mice. In his quest to hand over Chicago to the chairman, he ends up demolishing most of the city. In the end, the biker mice were able to locate and rescue the mayor and save the city from the evil Plutarkian. Greasepit works as the muscle man for Limburger, who goes around intimidating people at his command. He's an oddly shaped muscular guy who is always dripping with grease. He tries to follow commands and attacks the mice, but ends up failing every single time. He doesn't display any traits of smartness and intelligence and just does as he is told. His lack of thinking capabilities makes it easy for the biker mice to outwit and outrun him. He uses his appearance and brute strength to bully others into giving in to his demands. He's not as useful to Limburger as Carbuncle, but he is hardworking, obedient, and loyal.
We are Hanka
and Hanka,
the Loogie Brothers.
The Loogie Brothers. We don't need no stinking city. Carbuncle and Greasepit attempted to kill the biker mice with a time bomb. Fortunately, the mice managed to get rid of the bomb by using the gadgets on their bike. Frustrated with the failed attempts of his minions, Limburger decides to hire the scum of the universe, the Loogie Brothers, to take care of his problems. The Loogie Brothers arrive on their motorcycle in the middle of a game.
What's that smell? Did I step in something?
After a face-off with the mice, they pick up Charley as hostage and fly to the sky. Escaping the mice, they drop her to die. The mice save her by catching her mid-air and landing safely. Meanwhile, the people in Limburger's office continue to complain of a stink. The stink was so dreadful that even the Plutarkian wasn't able to ignore it. Carbuncle informs him of his discovery that the stench of the Loogie Brothers intensifies as they continue to eat junk food. If they eat a little bit more, they would be able to stink up the whole city. It gives Limburger a terrible idea. He decides to take the brothers around town to chase the people out of the city, thanks to the unbearable stink. The biker mice suspect Limburger behind the terrible smell and chase after his truck. The Loogie Brothers almost pass out after eating too much and continue to stink up the truck. The mice take Greasepit out of the driver's seat and take over the steering. They drive Limburger and the brothers into Limburger's tower and wait for it to take off like a rocket. Hacker and Honker Loogie were villains for hire from Plutarch.
You biker mice are not scaring us!
Yeah, we came prepared! Look!
They were popularly referred to as the scum of the universe, and they do live up to their title. The reason why they stayed behind on Earth after failing to take down the biker mice is that they fell in love with junk food. They do love a good chase and have no regard for human life. They work for whoever hires them, and their original plan didn't involve stinking up the whole city with their odor.
Thank you very much. And my hair.
Evil Eye Weevil. Lawrence Limburger once tried to send a running train into orbit and crash it, but his schemes were interrupted by the biker mice. Frustrated with the meddling mice, Limburger wondered what made them undefeatable. Greasepit's speech made him realize that the mice's strength relied on their unity. He wanted to come up with a plan to divide and attack them individually. Limburger was terrified when Carbuncle suggested Evil Eye Weevil for the task, as he was quite unstable. Evil Eye Weevil would shoot laser from his eyes and it would make his targets fume with rage for a couple of minutes. Limburger planned a trap to lure out the mice so that Evil Eye Weevil could shoot them and turn them against each other. Vinnie and Modo had been having their small disagreements for quite some time and settling their differences in their way. After getting shot with Evil Eye's rays, Throttle got tired of Vinnie and Modo's constant bickering, and in a moment of rage, the three went their different ways. When the hostility ray wore off, Throttle thought of going back to his bros and talking about what happened, but Evil Eye beat him to it and abducted Modo and Vinnie. Throttle learned about Evil Eye's involvement from Charley and put two and two together. While Limburger celebrated his victory against the mice, Throttle arrived to rescue his bros. When Evil Eye tried to attack him with his hostile ray, the mouse used his mirror to redirect the rays back to the villains. While the bad guys continued to bicker with each other, the mice used the orbit to send Limburger's tower into a space dump. Evil Eye Weevil used to perform stunts at a circus. He looked like a monkey trying to impersonate Elvis Presley. He was obsessed with his hair and would check out his reflection in a mirror every now and then.
Just let me check my hair.
His sidekicks, the Puke of Hazards, accompanied him everywhere. His sidekicks appeared to be slow-witted and absent-minded. They were just as useful to Evil Eye as Grease Pit was to Limburger. They had even forgotten to pack Evil Eye's ride with a parachute. His hostility ray would have caused a serious rift between the mice if Throttle wasn't aware of him and his abilities.
And you'll get blown into nothing.
I'll shoot first, Rodent.
Exterminator, Diet of Worms. The biker mice follow Carbuncle and Greasepit's truck as they head to an important meeting. Carbuncle unleashes new weapons and proceeds to attack them, but the mice use their bikes to get rid of the weapons. Carbuncle leaves a trail of worms behind as he rushes to his destination. The mice suspect that the Plutarkians are up to something and were gathering for an important event. They follow Carbuncle's truck and notice all the cheese-named villains, Gerald Gure, Jack Montere, and Galtima Galda, arriving at the destination. The mice disguise themselves as Plutarkian fish waiters to spy on the event. Lord Camembert had called the meeting for the best performing Plutarkians to decide who gets elected as the overlord of Earth after the takeover. He was disappointed to see Limburger at the meeting, who was filling in for Bree after giving him salmonella poisoning. Lord Camembert announced that whoever succeeds in removing the biker mice shall reign over Earth. The Plutarkian bosses were assigned personal supervillains to help with the task. Gerald Gure was assigned mechanic, Galtima Galda was assisted by Cycle Tor, and Jack Montere was paired with Ex-Terminator. The mice started to worry after hearing the plans about the target on their backs and the demolition of the planet. They were discovered by the Plutarkian bosses at the meeting, but managed to escape. The mice came up with a plan to turn the bosses against each other and take all of them down. They lured out the three worthy candidates to the same place and made them crash into each other. Limburger used this opportunity to catch the mice and put them behind bars and, by default, get selected as the overlord to rule Earth. The mice tricked the other bosses into thinking that Limburger would use them as subjects of Carbuncle's experiments. They convinced the bosses to delay the destruction of the planet to remove Limburger as the authority figure. They handed the mice the equipment they needed to break out from behind the bars and attacked them with Limburger as they tried to abort the ship. The device, meant to threaten the people of Earth, got destroyed in the crossfire, and the mice succeeded in foiling the Plutarkians' plan to take over the planet. Ex-Terminator was the first supervillain to be summoned by Limburger to go after the biker mice. Ex-Terminator had appeared briefly in the plot, but he was taken down by the mice in a matter of seconds. He had vowed his return while drowning in a grease pit. He is a robotic bounty hunter who rides in a customized combat motorcycle. His character was inspired by Terminator, and even his phrase, Hasta la vista, rodents, was a reference from Terminator 2.
Exterminator.
Hasta la vista, rodents.
He returned in a diet of worms to assist Jack Montere in taking down the mice and also help him to take down the other bosses.
Ask not for whom the bell tolls, rodent.
Yeah.
Cataclysm, Once Upon a Time on Earth, Part 1. a mysterious figure bombs several properties of Ronaldo Rump and steals the regenerators. Evil billionaire suspects biker mice behind the attacks and gives a media statement about the same. The mice were tasked with getting the regenerator from General Stoker and taking it back to Mars to revive their home planet, but the task proves to be difficult when Stoker is nowhere to be found. In the flashback sequence, we see General Stoker landing on Earth with the regenerator. Ronaldo Rump, a struggling car salesman at the time, was intrigued by the invention and decided to steal it from the alien. Meanwhile, Limburger and Carbuncle were up to their usual tricks to try and take down the biker mice. Carbuncle's new invention froze the mice in ice, and they were taken captive by the Plutarkians. Limburger had activated a device that was designed to suck everything from Earth and send it to Plutarch. The mice received unexpected help from another alien race and reprogrammed the device to suck in the materials from Plutarch. When Ronaldo Rump regenerated Limburger's plaza into his own tower, the ladies of the alien race appeared to him and offered him a deal that would be mutually beneficial for both of them. The aliens revealed themselves to be Catatonians who needed Rump's help to stay undercover on Earth. A fat man from an alien agency had helped Stoker from being arrested by cops. Nevertheless, he arrested the biker mice and took them to his ship. He removed his mask to reveal himself to be Lawrence Limburger, playing a different role and position this time. Cataclysm had a muscular build and was taller than Modo. He appeared as the second in command of the Catatonian army in the revived series. It was clear that he was the one calling the shots. He had a strong personality and a charismatic presence. He is just as strong as Modo in combat and relies on his laser gun. His sole focus was to take over Mars and get the regenerator for his planet. He is the older brother of Hannibal T. Hairball. When the biker mice arrived at the Rump Plaza to rescue Stoker, he stalled and captured the mice with his tactics. In the end, he was turned into a rat by the regenerator.
We'll make amusing little associate for our Dr. Catorkian.
Hannibal T. Hairball, Once Upon a Time on Earth, Part 3. Stoker had been captured by Rump and the Catatonians. He intended to exchange his inventions with either Plutarkians or Catatonians, depending on who could reunite him with his long-lost daughter. Nonetheless, she appeared just in time to rescue her father. The general bugged the Rump Plaza to track his updates. The biker mice rode in with their bikes while the girls resorted to enter the building by climbing it. Ronaldo Rump had decided to alter the regenerators to transform alien prisoners into world leaders. He wanted total control over the planet for his real estate business. He had staged a meeting with world leaders at his plaza and tasked Carbuncle and his personal evil scientist to use the regenerator as a machine for transforming aliens. While Cataclysm had captured the biker mice, Hannibal had captured the girls climbing into the building. All of them were put into a giant cage and brought to Ronaldo Rump. He wanted to use the mice to make up for the shortage of aliens in the total number of world leaders. Upon realizing that Spitfire shares the same DNA as Stoker, the mad scientist brought her out to work at the generator. She took the opportunity to turn the opponents into cats and rats. The event that ensued next was the regenerator purge, where most of the villains and Catatonians were turned into puppies. After taking down the enemies, she rescued her father and turned him back to his original form. They still had enough time to save Mars, so they redirected the beam towards the planet and turned the Catatonian soldiers into kittens. Hannibal T. Hairball was the younger brother of Cataclysm and the assistant supreme commander of the Catatonian army. He appeared as one of the primary villains of the revived series. He was short in build and didn't seem very bright. His presence wasn't as commanding as his brother's either. He had the personality of a typical cartoon villain whose plans would always backfire. He has displayed more childish and thoughtless behavior than the other villains. He was one of the few Catatonians to survive the regenerator purge. The reasons behind him being in charge of the Catatonian Empire is unknown. He doesn't have a weapon of choice and is always seen wearing a blue outfit with shoulder pads and medals.
If you liked our content, don't forget to leave a like and subscribe to us if you haven't already. Have a good one and be safe. Thanks.